chanting is the oldest extant religious expression of mankind. Its origin goes back to 5,000 years or more. Some historians believe that the people of the Indus Valley in northwestern India composed these hymns. Others believe that the people of the Indus Valley were displaced by migrants who brought with them these Vedic chants. In the centuries following the Vedas came the Upanishads, inspired works of several sages out of their mystic experience. They formulated three principles which became the foundations of Hindu thought and philosophy all through the centuries. I am not this body nor the ego. Our sages said so a long time ago. I am an eternal deathless soul, born many times, each in a different role. In each birth, my deeds good and bad make my next birth feel glad and sad. Yes, every time I carry my karma, which directs my earthly drama, I am but part of the cosmic soul. You too are a part of this infinite whole. The earth, the stars, you, me, and the sun, all the creation and the creator are but one. However, these profound principles of the ancient Indian rishis were contradicted in later centuries by an entrenched caste system in which men were considered unequal and some were even considered untouchable. The philosophical India and the ritual mundane India have coexisted for centuries as they continue to do today. Nevertheless, the areas of commonality between these are striking. For example, both the philosophical India and the ritual India respect the environment and considers all living beings and non-living entities like rivers and mountains as expressions of divinity because of the intrinsic faith that all creations are part of the divine infinite Brahman. The quintessence of the Vedas and Upanishads is contained in the Bhagavad Gita, which has become the most important scripture of modern Hinduism and has influenced many among the thinkers and philosophers across the world, being Krishna's sermon on the battlefront. The Gita is reinterpreted in every modern art form. The Ramayana is the other story of India which has eternal presence not only in India but in several Asian countries dominating Southeast Asia, as illustrated in this performance by a Kathak dance group at Bali in Indonesia. The conflict between ritual-bound Orthodox India and the profound philosophical India reached a flashpoint with the enlightened India emerging victorious in the persona of Gautama Buddha, whose message of peace and harmony spread all over Asia.
Namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasam buddhasya, namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasam buddhasya namo tassa bhagavato arahato sammasam buddhasya
namo ayariyanam namo.
Another great soul of India got enlightened contemporaneous with the Buddha. Bhagavan Mahavir preached ahimsa or non-violence as his basic philosophy. He has inspired India throughout the ages, including Mahatma Gandhi in the 20th century. In the 3rd century BC, about 200 years after the Buddha, India was ruled by one of the greatest monarchs of the world, Ashoka. His philosophy and concepts are reflected in this stupa in Sanchi in central India, built by him. If we jump a few centuries, Nalanda portrays the golden age of the Guptas in the first millennium after Christ. Nalanda was a great university with 10,000 students at its peak. It was a functioning university for almost 1,000 years. This is an age in which the great Indian scientist Aryabhatta invented the zero, gave place value for numbers, and evolved the numerals, which are now adopted worldwide. One of his colleagues discovered the decimal system of calculations, while yet another Indian found the rudiments of algebra. During the same period, Buddhist monks created the cave paintings of Ajanta, which are part of the greatest heritage of mankind. The sculptors of Tamil Nadu created these fabulous monolithic temples of Mamallapuram, dedicated to the heroes of Mahabharata. Lighthouse year stands testimony to the sea trade between India and eastern countries like China, as well as with Rome on the west. Not far from Ajanta stands another astounding testimony to the creative genius of India. Among the several cave temples of Ellora is the Kailasanatha temple, which is the largest monolithic monument of the world. It is dedicated to Lord Shiva. India also demonstrated its extraordinary ability in metallurgy. An iron pillar near Delhi, which has not rusted for over 1,500 years, stands testimony to the caliber of Indian metallurgists. The 11th century saw an extraordinary blossoming of Indian architecture. World-renowned temples such as Lingaraja Temple at Bhubaneswar, Khandariya Mahadeva Temple at Khajuraho, Brihadeshwara Temple at Tanjavur were all built in the same century, although they are in different areas of India. In the period of Cholas, contemporaneous with the great temples, some of the greatest bronze icons of the world were created by a combination of metallurgical skill and aesthetic finesse with spiritual fervor. The most known of the Chola bronzes is Nataraja, and the temple at Chidambaram is dedicated to this lord of dance.
Jata kataga sambhrama bhraman nilimpa nirjari vilola vichi.
While god Shiva and his consort Parvati are worshipped as primordial lovers, as the father and mother of all creation, as matter and energy, as cause and effect, Shiva is also worshipped as the cosmic dancer Nataraja. The Vedic concept of the creation and the creator being one and the same was re-emphasized by the saint Shankaracharya, who left an indelible mark on history. Born in Kaledi village in South India, Shankara travelled extensively all over India and brought together various branches of Hinduism under one umbrella. In the meantime, religions born outside India also began to have their impact on India. Saint Thomas, one of the apostles of Christ, is believed to have settled down in Chennai soon after the resurrection and meditated in this cave. Among the earliest Christian monuments of India is a tomb in a cathedral consecrated in his memory. The message of Islam too arrived in India far ahead of its spreading to other nations, which became Islamic states in later centuries. From the 11th century onwards, North India became a battleground of sorts for a few centuries, with several kings engaging themselves constantly in war. A sobering role was performed by Guru Nanak, who founded the Sikh religion, another religion born in the Indian soil, devoted to peaceful coexistence between conflicting religious groups. The sacred golden temple of Amritsar is a symbol of this message of peace and harmony. Babur, a Turco-Mongol descendant of Timurlane and Genghis Khan, conquered Delhi and established the Mughal Empire in 1526, an empire which held sway over large regions of India for over 300 years. The Mughal rule reached its zenith during the 40-year rule of Babur's grandson, Akbar. Almost 16 centuries after the Mauryas, Akbar was the first pan-Indian emperor. With the ability of a many-splendored man, he endeared himself to his citizens across all religious barriers. Architecture under Akbar's guidance represented an aesthetic synthesis between Hindu and Islamic features, reflecting the monarch's personality and paving the way for a composite culture of wider dimensions.